In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. In the waters of baptism, James died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory.
Of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry. All who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make the darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. Hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them, they turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.
I would like to offer a very warm welcome to all of you, together as we gather together in this church, presenting James Barron before the Father through prayer, and also, of course, as we celebrate his life and mourn his loss. I'd like to invite you all, please, to be seated, and then I'd like to invite Vance forward, please, for the words of remembrance.
When we met with Father to discuss this service, I asked him why the words of remembrance were not towards the end like other services that I had recently attended. Father commented back to me that getting to know JB a bit, certainly JB would want to start things off with a good laugh or two right from the start. Father, you're a good read. For those of you I don't know, my name is Vance, and I'm the younger brother of JB, or affectionately, as I refer to him as, Butthead. It's okay, he called me Buttface, and you could call these brotherly compliments to one another. No matter how you know James, JB, or Jay, or JB, I would bet we have at least a couple things in common. The first being that we could all close our eyes right now and hear his contagious laugh. Growing up with JB in the house, many of us in the family got to hear this laugh daily. And as we did, it really lightened our day. It was very, very special, and I miss it. Before going any further, the entire family who's here today, including JB's mom, Cookie, wanted to sincerely thank everybody for not just attending today, but being a positive impact of JB's life. It means really a lot to all of us. The second thing that we all have in common, besides sharing JB's contagious laugh, is we probably have a story or two or 10 as they rack up pretty quick, hanging out with JB. Let me share a few stories that you may not have heard. Now, boiling this down into just, you know, a few stories is pretty difficult, as JB had many passions, ranging from hanging out with people, to airplanes, to cars, to music, to sailing, to creative fixing, or something we refer to as Rube Goldberging. And if you haven't heard that term, we'll clear that up a little bit later. I'm going to boil these stories down into three parts of his life. One is his family, the second is flying, and the third is up north at the family cabin. First family. So James Barron Jr. was born April 13th, 1960 in Minnetonka, Minnesota, the son of James and Cookie Barron. We had a full house of six, and to sort of keep things clear, James Sr. Went by Dad or Jim, and James Jr. went by JB. JB attended Lindbergh High School, where he was involved in many activities, including sports of hockey and soccer. As well, he was totally into cars and airplanes. And at the time, he drove the coolest old white Cadillac around in the area, and he was the only one in his class to solo at the age of 16. Now, after high school, JB knew that he wanted to be a pilot, but he had to pick two different options to get there that were quite common at the time. One was the military, and the second was going through a university. He chose the university route, and he had two different options. One was Embry-Riddle, and the second one was North Dakota. JB, being smart and creative, actually picked Embry-Riddle to achieve two of his life dreams. One, to be a commercial pilot, and two, to go to college in Daytona Beach, Florida. This is an example of a gift that JB had. Get the job done, but never forget to enjoy getting it done. After graduation, JB had to find his way to build up his flight hours, so he became a bush pilot, up in Alaska, a flight instructor, and even got his A&P, or airframe power plant, which I thought was pretty cool that my older brother could actually fix the stuff and fly the stuff. For some time, he lived back home while he was building up those air hours, and he had to live by some house rules. One of those rules was to help with chores around the house, you know, just basic things that mom and dad would add to the list, and for him, this was no problem. The other rule when he moved back in is he still had to leave a note at the house, including where he was going and what time he would be back. This was way ahead of cell phones, and this was a hard rule of mom's. And there weren't many, but there were a few really hard rules. And this one was not quite as easy to digest for JB, since he had been living away, and as you all know, is a bit of an independent man. But regardless, he respected my parents and lived up to the rule 100%. But his daily notes would literally say this: I'm out, I'll be back later, love JB. Mom, which I think technically met both requirements of where he was going and the exact time, or when he would be back. Now JB the pilot, let's start with some stats. So according to the official records in the airlines, JB logged just under 23,000 flight hours, or that's 958 days, or 2.6 years in the cockpit. I asked him why he loved being a pilot so much, and he responded that he loved the mechanics of it, kind of the feel of the aircraft. He loved that each flight was a bit of an adventure. He loved it also that he didn't have a boss in the cockpit, and when he set the parking brake, he could enjoy the other things that he wanted to in life. One flying story that goes back to while he was building up flying hours actually in the area, flying out of Crystal Airport, when he would fly, that he was he knew he'd be somewhat in the area, he would call before he took off and actually let us know in ETA when he'd be around the house. And then whoever was at the house at the time would step outside on the deck with two bath towels and start whipping them around like this, like we're landing them on an aircraft carrier. Now, I'm guessing that he was definitely not under any sort of air surveillance, as I could see his eyes every time he would fly over. He flew over so low, and I believe I could hear his contagious laugh coming out of the cockpit a few times. JB got his hours done, or got the job done, and he never forgot to enjoy getting it done. As I mentioned, one of the reasons Jim liked being a pilot was that when the parking brake was set, he had opportunities to enjoy his other interests in life and explore. JB used his talents of fixing things and being creative mind to resolve many problems while working with very limited supplies while he was up north at the cabin. There was no Home Depot down the road, and what you brought up for the weekend is what you have for the weekend. So he got quite creative and used his ability to creatively fix things or Rube Goldberg things. And some of his famous or favorite tools of choice were copper wire, PVC tubing, duct tape, and the chainsaw. Now, the chainsaw was put to particular use because the property was quite large and heavily wooded. Every weekend, there'd be down limbs, and there'd be a new area to clear so the view from the cabin was better, especially for Grandpa from the deck. Now, the reward at the end of the day is all that wood would be thrown into a fire pit, and we enjoy the flames together and a good conversation. The fire pit now I'm talking about is not what you're thinking of in your backyard. That this thing was basically built to power a small city, putting out massive BTUs. And he set it up that you could basically throw anything and it would engulf it. Trusses, old lumber, old couches, mattresses, carpeting, paints, whatever it was. So in addition to keep things really interesting, JB would add some combustible elements in the evening. You know, things like kerosene, fireworks, and more. Now, I did not mention this earlier, but one of JB's passions was VW cars, you know, little cars and buses. And he got to know them so well, he actually knew the materials in the block, the engine block itself. And using this intricate knowledge and his passion to have some fun while getting the job done, JB surprised us one night by throwing in a VW block into the roaring fire. That was the surprise combustible element. He told us to step back, which actually made me a bit concerned. What that wasn't his typical MO that was there. And soon, the fire started to burn brilliantly, and there was this massive flash of light. It almost turned the night into day. What we didn't know, we had no idea, that, but JB knew, is that this VW block was made of the same material used in old flash bulbs that used to take our eyes out during pictures, magnesium. That night, JB got the job done of burning all the bush and the day's projects, and he enjoyed getting it done, certainly with a good laugh. James, Jim, Jay, or JB, it's way too interesting to summarize into just a few stories, and there are so many more that I'm sure all of you have. JB, when I asked Mom the other day of really what to say, she said, "Tell everyone, JB was a great big brother, and he taught you everything." I just rambled on for a bit with some stories, but that's the best summary I think there is. Thank you, JB, for being a great big brother. I love you.
All right. Hey, everyone. Thanks for coming. This is it's nice to see some of my Uncle JB's high school friends and friends growing up. It's been really cool to talk to you and hear a few stories. So my name is Max, and I'm JB's nephew, one of the oldest nephew, and I just wanted to share a few stories of my fun uncle, which he would call himself, and then later on that title became the naughty uncle. So so as a kid, when Uncle JB would come to town, it was always really exciting for us because my brother and I knew we were either one, gonna get a new toy, fireworks, or learn something my mom would never teach us. And we were all, my brother and I was like, always like, yes, we finally get to break some rules and not get in trouble. He just knew the little mischief thrills that kids enjoyed. Like this one time, he showed Nick and I how to secretly open Christmas presents in the middle of the night by cutting the corner tape with a knife or a box cutter. see what you got, retape it, and he'd tell us the most important part was to act excited the next day when you actually opened it. Another funny time was when he would take Nick and I on just a late night drive in the dark. He would come up to an empty intersection at a stoplight, and we'd be sitting there, and he'd be like, "All right, boys, so bet me $2, and I'll run this red light." And we'd say, "All right, JB, $2, $2. And he would just gun it and run the red light and just be laughing so hard with that infectious laugh he has. And Nick and I were just looking at each other like, no way he just did that. And if we ever got caught in the act by grandma or somebody, he would just always be our fall guy. Because in the end, Uncle JB just wanted to show us how to let loose and have a little fun growing up. So Another time at Christmas, you know, he bought us the Nintendo 64, which if you know back in the mid-90s, that was it. That was the thing. And so it was awesome to have that. Nick and I still have that at home, actually. We bring it out once in a while to play. In the summer, you know, he'd buy us illegal fireworks from Wisconsin every 4th of July and teach us how to light bottle rockets out of our hands. He taught us how to sail and how to rub Grandpa's sore feet. So, and last story here, I had a pretty cool experience with my Uncle JB in 2017, so not long ago. He came to visit me in Perth, Australia, when I was living there. And I was thinking, okay, cool, you know, my family had just been here, my brother had just been here, now I get to show my uncle this awesome this awesome country, see the wildlife, the ocean, surfing. But he finally gets to my apartment after 25 hours in the plane. He just looks tired and beat, and I'm like, Uncle JB, it's great to see you. I can't believe you're actually here. And he smiles and says, yeah, it's good to see you too, but goes, so where are the hot chicks at? Let's party. I didn't even know how to respond to that. I was just like, all right, let's get you cleaned up. Let's go get something to eat, and we'll talk about it. But no, so we went surfing together where he tried to surf with a walking cane. There's a picture out there if you want to look. We had beers together with kangaroos. We ate kangaroo together. We did this pretty cool prison tour, and he was the first family member to meet my now wife, Mel. So that was a pretty cool experience. So I was able to share a few of those memories with him on the phone a few days before he died, and could definitely hear him smiling through the phone. So yeah, thank you all again for coming. I'm definitely going to miss him, but I know he lived the life he loved, so thank you.
I drove through a couple of those red lights today, but I didn't end up actually going since it was midday, but thought of Uncle JB, of course. A reading from Ecclesiastes. Everything on earth has its own time and its own season. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to harvest. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to destroy and a time to rebuild. A time to cry and a time to laugh. A time to throw stones, and a time to gather them up. A time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search, and a time to lose. A time to keep silent, and a time to speak. A time to love, and a time to hate. A time for war, and a time for peace. God has permitted us to consider time from beginning to end, yet we cannot fully understand the whole scope of God's work, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is my shepherd, nothing shall I want. He leads me by safe paths, nothing shall I fear. The Lord is my shepherd, nothing shall I want. He leads me by safe paths, nothing shall I fear. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. Fresh and green are the pastures where he gives me repose. Near restful waters he leads me. He revives my soul. The Lord is my shepherd, nothing shall I want. He leads me by safe paths, nothing shall I fear. He guides me along the right path for the sake sake of his name. Though I should walk in the valley of the shadow of death, no evil would I fear, for you are with me. Your crook and staff will give me comfort. The Lord is my shepherd, nothing shall I want. He leads me by safe paths, nothing shall I fear. You have prepared a table before me in the sight of my foes. My head you have anointed with oil, my cup is overflowing. The Lord is my shepherd, nothing shall I want. He leads me by safe paths, nothing shall I fear. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell for length of days unending. The Lord is my shepherd, nothing shall I want. He leads me by safe paths, nothing shall I fear.
Would Andrew come forward for the second reading, please?
A reading from the book of Revelation. The angel showed me the river of life, coming from the throne of God, and flowing crystal clear down the middle of the street. On either side of the river were the trees of life which bear fruit, and the leaves of the trees were used for healing. God's servant was praising and worshiping him. She will see God's face, and God's name will be written on her forehead. She will not need lamplight nor sunlight, because God will be shining on her and will be her light. It will never be night there again. She will reign with God forever and ever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. There was a scholar of the law who stood up to test Jesus and said, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? How do you read it?" He said in reply, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your being, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." He replied to him, "You have answered correctly. Do this and you will live." But because he wished to justify himself, he said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man fell victim to robbers. As he went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, they stripped him and beat him and went off, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the road, but when he saw him, he passed by on the opposite side. But a Samaritan traveler who came upon him was moved with compassion at the sight. He approached the victim, poured oil and wine over his wounds, and bandaged them. Then he left him. He lifted him up on his own animal, took him to an inn, and cared for him. The next day he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper with the instruction, 'Take care of him. If you spend more than what I have given you, I shall repay you on my way back.' Which of these 3, in your opinion, was neighbor to the robber's victim?" He answered, "The one who treated him with mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated just for a moment. I'd like to welcome all of you once again. And of course, if I may, on behalf of Immaculate Heart of Mary, offer all of you our heartfelt condolences at the loss of James or JB. And I just have to comment, it's so beautiful for me to hear and to pick up, this might be too colloquial, but just the vibe that is present here today. It's clear there's a deep joy, which for some might seem strange for someone who died so young, but it's clear that that joy is out of deep appreciation and deep love for this beautiful man, and it's just a pleasure to hear it. It speaks volumes to JB's character, just to sense that. So I'm grateful myself to be able to be here to pick that up. I want to speak a little bit to our faith today, because of course that's one of the reasons that gathers us together. It's our faith that gives us a vision of something that we otherwise are not able to see by our normal senses, are not able to see, take in with our eyes, or to touch with our hands. But it's still real. It's a vision that is spoken to us of something that is happening right now, that is such a firm part of our hope, our hope that St. Paul speaks about as being sure and certain. And so it reminds us there is something that is taking place right now that we're not able to see. And I want to speak into that a little bit. Paul speaks about that vision. He says, "No eye has seen and no ear has heard what God has ready for those who love him." But he says those words not to try to get us not to think about it or to squelch what we are imagining, but just the opposite, to get us to imagine all the more, so that no matter what it is that we imagine, we just say, put on at the end of it, "Oh, but of course, it's so much better. It's more gentle. It's more wonderful. It's more beautiful, more amazing, more has greater depth to it, has greater beauty." So it's an invitation for us to imagine what JB is experiencing, again, as we are leaning into that firm hope of Christ. And I want to just add a little asterisk onto that. Sometimes what's so important for us to remember is that our salvation has so much more to do with what Jesus does than what we do. He has the bigger part. It's just important. I always want to say that. And so that's the reason for our sureness of hope. Not that we don't have anything to do with it. We do. But we're leaning into that sureness today in all that Christ has done. And so we can lean into that hope and imagine what JB is experiencing today. And if you, I want to ask for your permission to do that, just to open up the doors a little bit of what he may be experiencing. And with just the caveat, if none of it doesn't seem to apply to JB, you could just write it off and say, of course, it's so much better. Okay? But I want to do it especially by way of our gospel today. The family chose this gospel because I think we all know that JB was a kind of good Samaritan, of how incredibly generous he was with those around him, sharing his gifts, his technical gifts, his resources of time, but also his resources of money with people. And he would drop everything if someone was in need, how generous he was in that way. But I want to look at this gospel because, of course, this story of the Good Samaritan is given to us as an answer to a couple of questions. How can we be saved? And then later, who is my neighbor? And then Jesus, of course, begins to describe this Good Samaritan who dropped everything to help this person who was in such great need on the side of the road when everyone else walked past him. This Good Samaritan who noticed was willing to make a small sacrifice so that this person would live and be healed. And of course, the part of what Jesus here is drawing those who are asking him questions into, he's inviting them to begin to see that everyone around them, no matter who they are, is their neighbor. He's inviting them to have a transformation of vision. But sometimes what is missed is that secretly here, Jesus is also describing himself. That's this great work that he has done. That he, looking on all of us, we who I think we'd all be willing to admit are wounded and in great need, you know, as much as the gifts that we have, the treasures that we have, we're also in great need and wounded. And Jesus has drawn all of us close, has made all of us his neighbors, and of course he's gone further by making us his friends, by pouring on us, like this Good Samaritan did, the oil and wine of his own blood over all of our wounds. And how delighted he is to do that for us. He's made us his own neighbor. What's important for us, I think, in our imaginations to see by faith is that what all of heaven and what Jesus is seeing right now as JB is coming into their midst is this great image of Jesus in him, in JB. It's not going to be missed on them as they look upon his life of how profoundly generous he was, that he revealed an image of Jesus. And I just imagine heaven looking at those gifts of his with awe and with tremendous joy. It's beautiful to hear of his belly laugh and his joy. And just imagine how much joy is being added there as they look at his virtues and enjoy their own belly laugh of the joy that is being brought there in heaven. And of course, Jesus himself looking on him. It will not be missed by Jesus. Jesus was keen sight to see here is an image of myself, one who carried his light within him, bearing it for others as well. And of course, the Father looking upon JB, seeing an image of his own son, welcoming him in. And I just imagine the joy that is being experienced there. And of course, we just put a little asterisk, there's so much more goodness taking place. The other thing I think it's important for us to remember today is another aspect of our faith. And that is that our faith teaches us that JB's life is not really over. And it's so beautiful to hear your laughter, to hear your great appreciation for his love and the creative joy that he brought into your lives. It's important for us to remember that that isn't squelched when this life is over, when life here is over. And that love that was experienced by you especially isn't over. Because how could it be? Because now our faith informs us that he is going before the one who is love itself. And so the love and the joy that he had here on earth isn't over. It only increases that love for life is only increased because now he's experiencing it even more. He's experiencing the one who is love, the one who is life itself. And so I wouldn't be surprised if you continue to experience the beauty of him, of his care, because he is alive. And just to share a little story that Cookie shared, a beautiful story, the way he used to call his mom every night at 9 p.m., which is just a beautiful thing. That's so beautiful. But I was told that not long after he died, Cookie heard the wind close, very, very close to 9 o'clock, and where the chimes rang. And of course, it's a sign. It's just one of those signs that he lives. And of course, I'm sure that there will be more experiences of that to come. And so it's in that hope today that we are leaning into. It's that vision that we're meant to have burning in our hearts this morning. And so it's in that hope that we lean into. It's also in that hope that we pray. And that's one of the things we're meant to remember here, that it is hope, and our prayers are so deeply united to JB. And so we turn now to God in prayer. So I'd like to invite us to take a moment of silence just to give thanks for the gift of JB's life, and as we present him before the Father. Let's stand together now as we offer our prayers to our Heavenly Father. And I'd like to invite forward Mary, please, for the prayers of the faithful.
Please respond, Lord, hear our prayer. For Jim, who was given new life in baptism and nourished at the table of the Savior, may he now have a place at the heavenly banquet with God and all the saints in glory. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Jim's relatives, may memories of family times celebrated together be a source of gratitude for the gift of Jim's life. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Jim's friends, may their love and respect for him bring others together in friendship. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us here who are blessed in knowing Jim and loving Jim, may we live with the hope that one day we will share life with God and all our loved ones for all eternity. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we, your sons and daughters, come before you with gratitude to call you our Father, but also mourning the loss of Jim. We ask you would hear these prayers we present before you for him. and that you would welcome him into your loving arms. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. And I'd like to invite towards the back of the church those who are going to be presenting the gifts today.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on. Precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry. Hold my hand, lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When the darkness appears and the night draws near and the day my feet, hold my hand, take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home.
Please stand together. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Be near, O Lord, we pray, to your servant James, on whose funeral day we offer you this sacrifice of conciliation, so that should any stain of sin have clung to him, or any human fault have affected him, it may by your loving gift be forgiven and wiped away through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
like to invite you please to kneel or be seated as you're able. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Bernard, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant, James, whom you have called today from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
Let's stand together. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer one another the sign of peace.
Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us your
I invite you again to kneel or be seated as you're able. And for communion today, everyone is welcome if they'd like to come forward in the communion line. If you won't be receiving communion today, simply make a sign like this and we'll be happy to give you a blessing. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Eagle's wings bear you on the breath. breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. You need not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. For to his angels he's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. And hold you, hold you in the palm of his hand.
Let's stand together and let us pray. By the power of this sacrament, Lord, we pray, lead us always in your love. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that your servant James, who today has journeyed from this world, may by this sacrifice be cleansed and freed from sin, and so receive the everlasting joys of the resurrection, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Just want to make a quick announcement. So immediately following our service today, I want to invite everyone to, as we exit the church, to make our way directly outside for the releasing of the doves. And then, of course, the family invites all of us to Fireside Hall afterwards for a luncheon. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Shall hold you, the peace of God enfold you, the love that dreamed and formed you still surrounds you here today. The light of God beside you, above, beneath, inside you, the light that shines to guide you home to the loving hand of God. May God's light shine ever upon you. May you rest in the arms of God. May you dwell forevermore in communion with all the blessed. The hand of God shall hold you, the peace of God enfold you, the love that dreamed and formed you still surrounds you here today. The light of God beside you, above, beneath, inside you, the light that shines to guide you home to the loving hand of God.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother James in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon James in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. In peace, let us take our brother to his place of rest.
Shall we gather at the river, where bright angel feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing by
saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. On the margin of the river, washing up its silver spray, we will walk and worship ever. Oh, the happy golden day. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Ere we reach the shining river, lay we every burden down. Grace our spirits will deliver and provide our robe and crown. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Soon we'll reach the shining river, soon our pilgrimage we'll see.